And this is the Omron sensor I use in there. It's just an LED and a photo transistor with a gap between them.
PTFS.
Another PTF.
Yeah. I mounted on a little sliver of circuit board so I'd have something to connect the leads to, soldered that to a piece of malleable brass and over to a spot where I could anchor it, and I used that thin brass so I could bend it around into the right position to align it with my little claw simulator here. So this thing's going up and down three times for each cycle. When the cam doesn't block it, it moves in. And you see it here in the in position, then that time it moves down, it breaks the beam on that. When it pulls out, it fires off my signal for my frame capture. This is a circuit I found online that I modified. The LED is driven through a resistor, and the output transistor has a pull-up resistor on it, which worked out really nice. I connect this with a stereo mini plug to the projector. This is in the projector here. And because everything's through resistors, if it shorts out, when you're plugging it in, there's no problems here. Because the 5-volt power is being stolen from the mouse, and the last thing I want to do is ground out my supply in my computer.
Bern and I can tell you tales about static electricity.
Yeah.
And, this kind of thing.
It uses a quad Schmidt trigger, which I'm using as buffers or gates, but I didn't need that. The second stage in this thing just uses a little RC filter on here. What this does is the pulse is limited by the charging time of the capacitor and squared off again by another stage. The purpose of this is to give me a consistent pulse size regardless of the projector speed. So if I want to tweak it, nothing's going to change in here. I wanted predictability. The next thing I ended up doing, because I couldn't get it to work as they had it, was add two NE555 timers as one shots in here. The first one is adjusted to give me a variable time delay to make sure that my capture starts on the next full frame. I don't want it to come too soon, because this thing's faster than that clunky mechanical switch they were selling. The second one adjusts the width of the output pulse to overcome the contact bounce filter on the mouse input. Typical USB mouse, you have nice 5-volt supply in here, so I stole that to power it. The mouse circuit is all on one chip in there, and the left mouse button is just grounding a logic input, so all I had to do was tap that. If you noticed on the last one, there was a diode on the output. That was there because the early version had a regular mouse all in one piece, and I was afraid somebody would push the button and short the output, and I found it worked fine with the diode in there. I also added a toggle switch on the output, which allows me to disable this while I rewind the film without having to unplug the mouse all the time. This is the actual, or one of the boxes. It's the same as the one in the other room, the finished product. I ended up throwing away the mouse, just keeping the circuit board and mating it all in one box where it's now safe from being shorted and people pushing buttons. And there, with
this is safe?
Yeah, I wouldn't touch that.
Well, it's close up.
Well, when it's put together, it is. One or the other room is all working and calibrated. But that's for experimenting.
Did you make your own circuit boards? Or?
Yes. They're very ugly. I just paint the traces on them. I could give a lecture on how I make circuit boards without spending money.
You didn't etch them, you painted them.
I etched them.
Oh, you etched them.
Okay. Yeah, but I use nail polish as resist because the pen stuff never worked.
Right.
I can never get the I forgot what that other formula is. I like the, I have a brain freeze.
Ferric chloride?
Ferric chloride is what I like to use, but that seems to burn through the Sharpie pen resist. Mm. So I just started using, I put a fine tip brush on a bottle of nail polish and I just painted on with that. Looks crappy, but it works really good. And
what
really
color
cheap.
Nail polish do you use?
Doesn't matter. Anything dark enough, you can't use clear because you can't see what you're doing over the top. But any ugly color that somebody
Do you get any strange looks when you procure this material?
No, I just, actually, I'm still using the bottle of nail polish from my mother's discards 20 years ago. It goes a long way. I don't make that many circuit boards. The results were very pleasing. I'm happy with what I got, but I discovered that when I did the frame rate conversion and put in the interlacing so that it would work on a normal television set, that created all kinds of artifacts in there, much worse than any of the artifacts you get from anything else that's going on. The other problem was is I have a lot of sound, single system sound, and to get the sound back in sync, recorded separately, was difficult to impossible. And I kept looking around for a better way to do it. And I went in with my friend. We got a Super 8 sound projector that was set up for this capture. And it was touted as flicker-free, but we didn't read the fine print. It was flicker-free at 20 frames per second. And my whole family sounded like the chipmunks. But I was looking at this cheap program I had. I bought this capture outfit. It cost me $20 online. It's a USB dongle that has S-Video in, and it came with ULEED Photo Studio, an obsolete version of it. The whole package was $20, including shipping. And I noticed it had an icon on there that says Speed Adjust. And I looked at that screen, and it says keep, maintain pitch, or vary the speed of the sound. And I simply took the 20-frame capture, put it in there. I says, play it back at 90% speed, sound and video. Voila, perfect 18-frame video. Now, running the projector at 20 frames gets rid of the problems. And this is something I found out Adobe Elements has the same feature in it, do the same thing. So we can capture all our sound film, 24 frames or 18 frames, at 20 frames with no flicker, and then let the editor software readjust the speed, and the artifacts in there are trivial. The interlacing gives you a lot of bad frames if you do freeze frame on there. Sometimes you have to skip to the next frame to get a decent picture. But viewing it at normal speed, my conclusion is the improvement isn't worth the effort to go to frame capture. If you want to do sound, that's the only way to do it. Or if you just want to do it in a hurry without spending a lot of money, that works too.
Dennis, you know about the features of Cool Edit / Adobe Audition for doing pitchless time changes and timeless pitch changes.
Right, but you don't want to change the pitch. You want it to.
Well, I'm just saying you can also change pitch and speed together, but you can do that to the soundtrack separately with.
Doing it separately and putting it back together is a major challenge, especially on blurry amateur film. It's really hard to identify the lip sync. I tried it and didn't have a lot of success. It was a hell of a lot of work.
Well, I could, you know, the one of the tricks for doing that without a lot of hassle is you modify what you're digitizing so that there's like a something big in the video and something big in the audio that all you have to do is line up.
Well, if you plan ahead for that, yes, but if you're working with junky film shot by amateurs after the fact, none of the sound projectors have the speed accuracy where it's going to stay in sync from one end of the roll to the other. The frame capture is digitally accurate. It's absolutely perfect speed, but the cameras aren't. As a matter of fact, some of this stuff, I may even go back and modify it again because the camera itself wasn't perfectly on speed and it still doesn't sound correct to me. It still sounds like it's running fast even at 90%.
So how much film do you and your friend have to go through to digitize?
He's got a couple of shelves full of film. his father was a photographer for the UAW, so he grew up in the darkroom, and he has tons of film to do. I don't have a very big collection, but I had enough to fill up 4 DVDs. And when we were developing our sound movie product, we used my family as guinea pigs and created a demo movie. And they were great, especially one sister. They hammed it up really good for us. So it made a real cute film. And I can show some examples if people want to see what it looks like. But, the biggest problem I had with the 20-frame capture, our regular 8 sound projector just doesn't have good speed regulation. I could get it close enough where it would work, but every time a splice went through, it would waver in speed, and you could see the distortions in there. The Super 8 system I have is that expensive projector we purchased, and that has electronic speed control and seems to be really stable. And I can set it and forget it. It stays dead nuts on speed. One thing I've been toying with is the idea of capturing at 30 frames per second, which would require synchronizing the projector with the camera so that the pull down matched the frame rate of the camera. I'm not sure how practical this is. It'd be fun to try it.
What are the problems?
The problem is when you're going at 20 frames, you randomly have half frames mixed in there anyway. At 30 frames per second, you could end up synchronized halfway where you're interlacing pictures from two different frames.
But you've got an electrical signal that tells you when your claw is pulling the...
Yes, but you would have to have electronic drive in the projector so you could keep it synchronized with the video camera. To make sure that that pull down
is
phase locked.
Hard or is that trivial?
That's what I did. Mine is phase locked.
Yeah. Must be trivial.
Are you doing it at 30 frames?
No, at 20.
At 20. It'd be interesting to see if you.
I'm not sure my projector could run at 30.
Yeah.
But if your projector can run at 30, then it should be reasonable to do.
One big advantage of capturing at 30 frames with sound is that when you slow it down, all sound projectors have crappy heads in them. They all have lots of hum. So if you're capturing at 30, when you slow it down, you're reducing the hum frequency even farther, which is really nice. That's a side benefit of that. But in truth, 20 frames works surprisingly well. And...
Maybe that's another question. If you have problems with hum, once you've gotten it down as much as you can use software like Cool Edit or Dolby Edition and just notch it out.
You have to remember to notch it before you do the speed change if you want to use the pre-configured filter.
Well, you can notch it. You can notch it at whatever frequency it happens to be because the notch filters are. You can tune them as carefully as you'd like to.
Yeah, but if you do it in the right order, it's a no-brainer. I mean, they have a standard algorithm built into Cool Edit Pro or Audition that you can use.
Well, yeah,
you do it first before you do the speech.
They have presets for standard hum frequency.
Yeah, and it works fine. I did it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So... that's my conclusion in this. I can show you samples of both frame capture and running at a 20 frames, and I don't see that much of an improvement with the frame capture.
I'd like to see a sample.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, all this talk about theory is fun, but it's always, rubber hits the road, right?
Yeah. I'm going to start out with the 20 frame capture. This is stuff I shot using that camera that we borrowed from Guardian Photo.
I don't know about you, but it was tough getting to sleep last night.
It's not exactly HD.
No, and that's what I mean, that it's just not worth going to an HD camera for it.
Not bad.
No. I mean, the color is...
This is ektachrome film on a low-light camera.